Richard Ash Show. Brought to you by the Club of Amsterdam.
Welcome, I'm Marleen Sticker. We are at De Waag. I'm having a conversation with Umberto Schwab. He is the founder of Socratic Design. And we're talking about Europe, technology, and humanity. Umberto, where is Europe at this moment? What is the story that we can tell about Europe?
Well, that's a very important question. What is the story we can tell about? There are probably hundreds of stories to tell about Europe, and that's the typically character of Europe, the diversity of the stories. Is there also a common story? I think yes. You know why? Because if you ask a Belgian or a German people, is there a European story, they will say no. But if you ask an American tourist, do you know what is Europe? They say, yes, we immediately know what is Europe. So there is a European story in their customs, in the way we behave, in our way of making personalities. And that has been very strong in the past, always connected to dramas in the past. So we cannot realize our lives today without thinking about the Holocaust, for instance. But Europe has also, I would stress, Europe has not also a diversity, which is very important, but it also has a very strong promise in its narrative since periods like Renaissance. So that's what I think is, you can say, the roots of the story for the future.
So Europe has a story, but mostly we don't identify ourselves with it. But from the outside, you can see something which we have all in common. And you say it has something to do with the Renaissance. Can you explore this a little bit more? What is then this storyline? What is this narrative?
Yeah, that's if you ask people, well, people from the outside, from China, from the Arab countries or Latin America, they also want human freedom. They also want to develop themselves quietly. They also want to adhere the classical masters in music, art, and so on. So, what is this story? Well, the Renaissance is a very good example. It's and also already started in the Symposium of Plato, which is that's a very short life, and in that short life, try to give meaning in a beautiful and good way. And this sounds very positive, but if you look at the writers from Plato, from Pico della Mirandola in the starting the Renaissance, or all the Renaissance artists, even Leonardo, then we see that back, and we see that also in the moments that we have big dramas in Europe, and people have a sort of reverence that still we have to evaluate this striving or the quest of humanity to live every person. The person is very important, that every person has the access to leading a good life, and that means a good life, a meaningful life, which is at this moment quite difficult because we are penetrated by all different forces. Mm-hmm.
And if we look now at Europe, I would say there's a lot of the gele hesjes, the yellow, the people on the streets expressing their distress with globalization. Would you say this is these people expressing that they rather would go for the good and the beautiful?
Yes,
or
definitely.
Is this another
No, this is a perfect example. Because the people, that's also the tragic of social democracy in Europe. Social democracy in Europe at this moment has no narrative. The only narrative they have is the minimum wages or equality and that sort of stuff. But that's not what people want in their life. Basically, people want in their lives meaningful ambition. They want meaningful relations and they want to have a strong collective. And you can translate that to the import of migrants, but that is not their problem, really. Because the most people who are against immigration don't have immigrants around them. So it's a sort of a translation of an inner need in a lack of meaning. And you can say that the whole middle class has been forgotten to ritualize their lives. They have been transformed into just consumers. They have been transformed into just big data. So they have no, you can say, it's also part of our scientification of our culture. If you look at business, if you look at education, if you look at health, it's all based on rational, evidence-based, output-organized utilization of our public sphere. So that means that even, and you see that the best in the care for elder people, we don't mind that what they do the whole day, what is it, terrible circumstances, as long as we can make it more effective, more cheaper, we will do that.
So would you say that, when I listen to you, I would say that you also define that Europe approaches many of the these kind of things as health and education as purely market, yeah, where we all as citizens are consumers.
Yeah.
And this the idea of the good and the beautiful we have to find in more public
exactly
space.
Exactly.
In the public domain.
Exactly. So we have at the one part we have this instrumentalization also in science, in psychology, in sociology. At the other part we have this instrumentalization in business, in economy, and we have the complete illusion of the becoming free of religious limitation. So we had this sort of dream in the 60s. So when we leave religion, then we are completely there because we are free of all this taboos and of these laws and whatever. Now it appears that these religious rituals, if you are godless or not, were very important in organizing their meaningful collective tribal relationships in the public sphere. So you cannot have a public sphere just by itself.
So you need narratives, but do you need religion? In what kind of sense do you mean we need religion?
So religion used to be in Europe, and this is the core story of Europe, of course, also in the wars and also in the all sort of tragical conflicts, but religious. In the one side, it's dealing with the whole the things of the God and the existence of a life after this one. On the other side, it organizes the collective soul. So what we need in Europe is to be honest and say, we're not rational agents. We need, like animals, to have good collective structures in the common. Because that's what people say when they are moved out of their beautiful districts in the Jordan or in Barcelona, Barceloneta. They were destroyed because they say, this is better, this is more utilizing, it's more effective. And then people said, okay, we go there. And they didn't realize they destroyed their collective soul. Soul is also a word that should come back in the vocabulary. And that's very important in the Socratic design approach. But if we realize this, that soul, the collective soul, is maybe that what makes people worthwhile getting out of your bed, then we should do a whole different path than the Silicon Valley. So I see there a lot of perspective.
I think one of the things that we have been discussing before is the notion that people feel not really part of it or something, and that they feel left out.
Yes.
Especially when it's when terms as globalization, being objectified,
yeah,
being just a consumer. I think this whole notion of dignity would also mean that people feel that they're part of something again.
Yeah.
Do you see possibilities for Europe in this respect?
I see a lot of possibilities because that's also my practice, and I see you can create new practices overnight, and because of this awareness is deep-rooted in Europe, although we have that now, hidden, it's still there in our tacit ground. But you see more and more people coming to collective activities, can be in neighborhoods or helping fugitives or in food banks and so on. But it's a deep inclination, and it's basically a sort of paradigm switch from the Cartesian model. I am an autonomous rational agent. Also Sartre, that's very strong, existentialism. And also the hippie, I want this individual freedom. And this individual freedom, which is an atomic freedom at the end of the day, makes you meaningless. So people alone in their apartment cannot create that what is for 100,000 years or mode of living, which is just being together and then create meaning.
Yeah.
So I give you one, I was very impressed by an example of Alexander, who is a psychologist who discovered, we all know this rat locked up in a cave, and then there's the cocaine and there is the food, and he will take the cocaine till he dies, and he will leave behind the food. This was the model of Skinner for everybody to say addiction is an individual problem and you can have it, and you have a very weak DNA when you will fall in addiction, so we have to cure you. What did Alexander do? He said, this is not true. He said, people are dislocated into their loneliness, and when they are dislocated in their loneliness, they have pain. They have a sort of systematic pain, and this is the reason why they go into drugs, massive drug addiction or sex addiction or Facebook addiction.
So when we have a lot of rats that are socializing, they go for the food and not for the...
This is what he thought about. Let's do this experiment.
Yeah.
He did this experiment. He put rats in together with some toys, and then none of them went to the cocaine.
Yeah. So we have to leave out the cocaine for Europe and build on this collective soul, if I understand you right. And so this is a call to action to constitute this.
Yes.
Can you give us a final idea how to come to this point?
Yeah, well, I think it's very urgent to come to this point because singularity, Silicon Valley has their narrative. I think we in Europe should make this narrative, and we should make this with players like Waag Society and in Barcelona and people like Francisca and you and all this sort of people who are very aware of this threat of, at the one side, of the technology. But also we need a lot of normal people or artistic people, creative people, to build a new narrative. And we use this methodology also already in different small scale. But you can do it on a bigger scale. You can say, you can have 300 people. We did it in the Ural Festival in the Netherlands. 300 people. What is our dream of how to live? And we, in one afternoon, we got it. So the next step is making narratives, roll them out, and put your money there. And then you can put the technology to support this.
Yeah. Okay. So the idea is that we, to build this narrative, which brings us back to a society that we all can play a part in, we also have to build it together. So it's also a collective approach. It's not some people who write this for us. It's actually really a design process where people have to be involved in. Okay, thank you very much.